Okay. We are sitting here in Graz. I'm trying to get this a little bit of a better angle for this camera. That's better. And we're going to fly over to Birmingham. In a good old England. Exactly what sound is the mixer picking up? I'm curious. Is it from the game? Yeah, okay. We are going to be flying this beautiful, in my opinion, biased opinion, because I made this myself, McLaren livery for the Airbus A320neo from Fly-by-Wire. So, we're going to take this baby over to England, a couple hours flight. So let's not waste too much time getting ourselves rolling here. Let's get the stats refreshed. There we go. It's a 741-mile flight, so it's not a short flight. And I would suggest that we just get on with it. I think everything is pretty much good to go. So, happened to the camera there now? This is weird. This is a different camera that I'm using. It changed. I swear to God, it just changed. That's better-ish. All right, let's. I think I forgot to do one thing. I think I need to switch this back over to the controls for the fly-by-wire. Yeah, sure do. I never know which direction. They really need a drop down for this because this is just painful to scroll through and having to wait for it to update every time. It's not alphabetical or anything. It's just some random ass order. Super annoying. Okay. This is the updated version of the fly-by-wire development version, which I believe now has a. It's supposed to have Navigraph. Oh, Jesus. Navigraph chart integration for the EFB. This should be Flypad OS version 2 or something. We're not going to actually mess with that because I don't have that. I don't need it. I've got obviously maps down there. So, but that is super nice. Very happy for them to have done that. That's good stuff. Good stuff. Let's get the batteries on. That did nothing, but I'm not actually sure if it's set up to do anything. External power on. Get the ADRs set. So nav, oxygen, crew supply on. Emergency light switch armed. Seatbelt on. No smoking is on auto. That's all good. Beacon. Nav lights. Cockpit lighting. It's early in the morning. Don't really need much lighting here. APU master switch. Monitor ECAM for APU. Oh, I see. That's interesting. Okay, I was trying to be smart with, showing and hiding stuff on the VATSIM thing. Okay. Still leaves the blurriness, though, of course. Yeah. All right. Well, that's fine. I guess we'll leave them on. We're not flying on VATSIM. Too lazy. Too much work. APU's come up. Let's get the APU started. There's our GPS on. APU is coming up. Meanwhile, we can quick look here at our settings. Let's get this all going. Should load in the flight. DHL 43, which I think is correct. That is the one that I had planned. So that's excellent. I don't actually know what that does, but I think that's maybe. Well, that's all good anyways. Let's get a quick weather request in for Roz. Get that sent out. The APU should be fully on now. It is indeed, so we can go up to the top and disconnect external power. We'll continue our FMS setup here, so we should probably have. Did I not hit send on the messages? Perhaps I hadn't. The fuel set properly and the payload. Okay. Init request. Give me that flight plan. Fuel block confirmed. That's all good. Departure arrivals. Let's just have a quick look at the flight plan. We are today, and I always have this chart up earlier than I really should. We are departing runway 34 center with the MIL G5. MIL G5U. Departure. Insert that. And we will be landing using the. What are we doing today? At the end of our flight, the Silv 1 Bravo arrival. This is all going to ILS runway 15. And Silv 1 Bravo. Transition. We're flying here, obviously, for the Silverstone Grand Prix, so we are flying to Birmingham, which is, I think, physically the closest airport that we could find. So let's have a quick look at our. Let's go to plan mode, and let's have a quick sort of jot through the legs. That looks good. Looking for any weird disconnects. We've got lots of waypoints along the way. It is a bit of a lengthy flight. And that looks close enough to me. That looks good to me. Okay, one final piece of setup. The performance. Yes. We will do flaps one takeoff. So we rotate at 133, transition altitude 10,000. That's good. Get rid of all this stuff down in the bottom here. Let's just quickly jump back and get our weather report, which we should have received by now. Yes, you had to do it twice. All right, we'll take the one that is a few seconds fresher. Get that printed out, and we are good to go and ready for engine start. We'll lock the door, predictive wind shear on auto, APU bleed on, please. Fuel pumps on. And got the ignition switch moved on, and we are basically ready now for pushback. Let's just collect this. Outside, we definitely do need pushback. Let's have a quick look at how we want to position ourselves here, though. This is where we do want the chart. 34 center, so it's actually down in the direction that we are facing, so I guess we will probably just taxi via Bravo, and then we have to go all the way down to the end and turn around. Wait, that's 34. Where is 34 center? It's gotta be. Yeah, okay, it's the big one. Okay, I forgot to launch Pushback Express. Let's hope it doesn't need an update. It does not. Good.
Cockpit to ground.
Go ahead, flight deck.
We will be ready shortly.
Roger.
Is there going to be a tug actually coming to us here? I did not pick a very good parking spot. Didn't manage to find a gate. I just found like a random parking spot. So I'm guessing we're just going to need some fictional pushback here without a actual tug to push us. But that's just how it is. That's fine. We do not mind too much. Let me just make sure the throttles are functioning. They are. Good. Alright.
Cockpit to ground.
Go ahead, flight deck.
We are ready for pushback and engine start.
Roger. Release the parking brakes, please.
Parking brakes released.
Pushing back.
And there's our magic non-existent tug. We're going to turn ourselves immediately in this direction so that we can get ourselves nicely lined up, because we want to go down there. We're just going to taxi around the apron here.
And you can start your engines at your discretion.
I got an engine starting. Yes, I do. For some reason, controlling the tug from outside the airplane does not work. I have to be, like, inside of it. It's a bit weird. That seems like a new bug. Oh, maybe that's because I think I can do it in this mode. Yeah, so it's weird because the drone camera, also you don't get to see your actual flight controls moving. I don't know why, but it seems as though Pushback Express has stopped.
Pushback complete. Set parking brakes, please.
Parking brakes set.
Roger. Okay, the tow bar is disconnected and the equipment is clear. We will see you on the left side with the pin.
Thanks, and you can disconnect and go to hand signals.
Thanks.
Engine is on. Hello, Gaming Network 24/7. Thanks for the follow. Yeah, it's going to be... I mean, it's such a great game. Hopefully it will be... Did I actually get us into the building? Yeah. Oops. Oh, no. No. We just barely made it. Of course, we're going to melt part of the side of the building with our engines now, but... it is a great game, and hopefully it will run okay on the Xbox. I don't know how well or not well that's going to go. That's going to be interesting. But, yeah, you Xbox gamers are going to enjoy the hell out of it, I'm sure. It is just really good. Nice bit of rain right ahead of us there. So as soon as this engine is on, let's do our before taxi. There we go. Oops, wrong button. We can turn off APU bleed and turn off the APU master switch. Okay, that now taxi lights are on, flaps to 1. Speed brakes, spoilers armed. ATC auto, TCAS, we're not going to worry about. And let's go and taxi. Sorry, Xbox. Yeah, Xbox Series X, of course. I don't know how well this would run, if at all, on... on the old generation hardware, probably not so well at all. It's pretty beefy. It requires a fair bit of attention, a fair bit of hardware on PC. I'm sure it's going to use all that the Series X can throw at it, and then some. So I guess we do need to do this real quick. Get out of the way! Get out of the way! This is a big file. Oh, did we just miss our turn?
Yeah, we did.
Oops. Okay, I guess we're taxiing around. I don't know why it's this company message still. I thought I had read that. We missed our turn off. Was too busy trying to clear notifications on the MCDU that we missed our turn, so now we gotta go through this parking lot. Run over a bunch of people. I've cleared it. I guess we got to follow that bus over there. It runs okay for me. It runs great for me. Well, great is a bit of an overstatement. It runs really well for me, but I do have a pretty beefy CPU and a 3090. So, you know, I do have a lot of hardware in here. The next update, though, Sim Update 5, which should be coming out soon this month, is supposed to bring some pretty significant optimizations, which is probably related to the Series X launch. They probably had to optimize it a bunch more to make it work well. So the understanding is that they've done that, and that's coming to PC later this month, which is exciting because, yeah, we could use a little bit more FPS. Runs great for me for what it is, but, you know, could always have more.
Tennis, please prepare for takeoff.
Hey, that's new. That is new audio. Okay, cabin is ready. Everything is ready to go, except for my autopilot. Let's have a quick look at our departure chart. Milgo above 10,000 at 3,500 initially at Milgo 5 uniform. Okay, so 3,500 initially. So we'll set that, then 10,000, and then we are good to go for whatever our cruise altitude is, which, just double checking, flight over 380. So 3,500, 10,000, 380. It's worth it though. Like, I mean, it depends. If you love this game like I do, you're gonna do just loads of stuff with it, and it's just super enjoyable. It's just really good. And the good news is that, like, this fly-by-wire A320neo is so good, it's in the marketplace, which means I'm assuming you'll be able to get it on the Xbox. Some of the other mods that are out there that are really good, I don't know if you can, if you're able to get those on the Xbox, because they usually, at least on PC, most of them are not necessarily in the store. They're like manual installs, so I'm assuming you wouldn't have access to that on the console, but I could be wrong. Well, no, maybe there will be ways to do that. Maybe they're aiming to put some of the, I'm thinking of the working title stuff in particular, but those guys are now hired by Asobo and Microsoft, so their stuff is going to be making their way into the official game as improvements for everybody, which is great because they're very, like, vital improvements. Come on, turn, baby. I know you're heavy here. It's a tight turn, but okay. We are lined up. Everything is good. We are ready for takeoff. Let's go to 50% of the engine power. Yeah, no, I know the Neo comes, but let me put it this way. This Neo is based on that one, but it has been made significantly better than the stock one that comes with the game. So you're going to want to get... Is there a guy on the runway? Wow, this guy again. Unbelievable. What is it exactly that you don't like here, autopilot? Why can I not get it into the lever climb? Strange. That was a bit weird. I feel like it's in the climb detent. Nice view of the city. It's weird that we have to be at 3500 at this point. Seems like we should be able to go higher, but we're not able to. So, what we are now, so let's go to 10,000. Thrust climb, okay, that's good. 2,500. Look at this beauty. That looks so good. I don't do much actual like online flying with other people. It works okay sometimes. I have not always been very successful actually getting into the same session with people. Or I shouldn't say that. We've been able to get into the same session, but we haven't always actually been able to see each other. So again, there's some mods, and I personally really like VATSIM, which means all your ATC has other real human beings on it. So the online mode itself is fairly limited. It's not that great. Let's go up to flight level 380. And we'll be all set. Crossing through 10,000 any moment. Did remember my name for once. Now, where are the settings? There we go. All set. Life weather looks good, yeah. I don't know, it's not always the most accurate, but it looks like the weather in this game looks really phenomenal, actually. Looks really good. I feel like we're not climbing very fast. If we are, it just doesn't seem like it. 3,500 feet a minute? Okay, alright. Landing lights come off, standard barometer. Seatbelt signs come off. Yeah, the weather looks, I mean, it looks really pretty in this game. I do like it a lot. Some people don't always like it for whatever reason, because it's, you know, it's not, there just seem to be an abundance of thunderstorms, like too much lightning, and maybe a little bit too much icing on the planes, but like weather-wise, it looks beautiful. Even the ugly weather looks beautiful, you know what I mean? Alright, that's our departure done. About 2 hours to our destination. Alright, that seems to match up just about right with what I had planned, I guess. The iPad thing, well, it's just two apps on it, but they do connect to the game because of some software that I'm running, and that is not part of the base game, so I imagine that that probably won't work on the Xbox. However, you can still use these apps to get, you just wouldn't be able to get the actual flight tracking, like where the plane is, but you can still get the charts. It's a subscription though, it's called Navigraph Charts. But there are some free ones too. There's some really great free tools. Little Nav Map is one of them that I would highly recommend. It's not an iPad app though, it's just like a Windows app or Mac or whatever you have. But it's free. It's really good for flight planning and finding airports and finding the right routes and all those things. And I thought I launched this. I guess I didn't launch this. There we go. Now we have stats at the top. Proper stats. Look at these clouds, man. Somewhere below there is Austria. Little bits of it. Is that not working anymore? Interesting. Well, that's good. Yeah, yeah, the skins, there's so many nice skins. I really hope that they will have some way that you guys on Xbox are able to use them. There must be, because it's such a big part of the game. There must be a way for you to use them. I don't even know how to respond to that. I didn't even know people could message me on the stupid Xbox Bar app. Still just like just ugly, ugly weather below us, though. I actually bought it, but that's because I wanted to, and I knew I was gonna. You can see. I mean, this stuff. I dumped a bunch of money into it because I really enjoy it, but. I have lots of friends that play it just off Game Pass because it's, you know, it's part of Game Pass, and you get not the premium version, I don't think. You just get the regular one, but still, that has loads and loads of content. Gotta love Game Pass for that stuff. It's amazing, amazingly good value. I should probably not actually be in plan mode. There we go. That's a bit better. Also really look at the there we go. Not turbulent. Let's make sure people sit down for now. Let's get some music going. Not sure if I want this song though exactly. Pretzel, it's not so great. Just a little bit of bumpy air. I bet you if we look out the wing, we're going to see it flexing quite a bit in this turbulence. Yep, there it goes. Hey, Sean, am I aware that you are late for the race? Yeah. Well, my understanding is that McLaren didn't show up really anyway. So that's not really surprising, is it? Actually, I do want to check something though. Yeah, I didn't watch the sprint race either. I don't know. Was it any good? And the engines are still so loud, no matter what. Oh, is it more entertaining? Yeah, I guess the regular qualifying is not that terribly exciting. I had originally thought about doing my flight tomorrow, and then during this, what is currently, I guess, an hour and a half of flight time, I was just going to watch the race on my iPad while I was flying. But then nobody was around to do anything else tonight, so I decided to go and fly instead and make this flight, because I really wanted it. It's such a nice. I love the A320. It's just such a super nice plane. And they've made a couple of nice additions. They're working on some great stuff there. I think they're getting very close to getting VNAV working, which is going to be amazing when they do. I cannot wait for that. So does this actually work now, that button, or did it not work? Okay, well then they did show up. That's almost a little bit low for Norris, but not bad for Ricardo. I'm sure Norris wanted to go higher than that for his home Grand Prix. You know, people keep forgetting that Hamilton is also from the UK. It seems like everybody's like, "Oh, Norris is driving at home." It's like, what about Hamilton though? Like, isn't he also? And Russell, oh, I keep talking about Russell, sorry. That's of course the big conversation. Oh, he does he? Well, that should be interesting. I look forward to watching it tomorrow. I hope it's a good race. I'm probably going to do another flight tomorrow morning as well, but that's going to be in my world tour. So I'm going to be flying from Chad to S the Central African Republic. I mean, I don't get the Russell hype either. The only thing that I know is, first of all, he's British and there's a lot of British F1 fans. Plus, he is supposed to be the next Mercedes driver, so to say. I think his manager is Toto, the guy who leads Mercedes. So, you know, the rumor, of course, is that he's going to be signed in place of Bottas for the next season. And they're basically saying that he's really good. He just needs a better car than the Williams car that he's in right now. And that may be true. I don't know. I'm always a little bit skeptical when it's talk like that. But I don't know. Seems like a nice enough guy. I don't know why though. I do have a like a soft spot for Bottas, so I kind of want to see him continue to do what he does, but right, we've used our cruise, reached our cruising altitude. Good drivers can make bad cars look good to an extent. Yeah, and I mean I think that's what they're thinking because he's been really good in qualifying lately. I think he's. What did I see? He has not yet been eliminated in Q1 at all this year. He's made a couple of Q3s now. So, you know, I feel like they're saying that he's a really good driver. He just, you know, needs to get the benefit of a better car to be in contention for podiums on a regular basis and points. Because obviously, like, this is going to be tough for Mercedes because it's, yes, they want Hamilton to get the driver championship points, but they still want constructor championship points too. And you know, say what you will about Bottas, but Bottas generally provides points that lead to the constructor championship. You know, Red Bull has got Perez to do that, and I don't know. I mean, if they sign Russell instead of Bottas, they must... Obviously, they're going to need points out of Russell. They're not just going to get Russell to, like, drive somewhere around between 10, 15 spot. Teams are limited to two cars, yes. But they have these weird, like, there's cross relationships. So, I believe AlphaTauri is almost like a farm team for Red Bull. And I think Williams is kind of like that for Mercedes. So, like, behind the scenes, I think a lot of these large companies, teams, they actually do have two teams with two drivers each. Two cars each. But I don't know exactly the details of that. But I do know that there are certain relationships between some of the top teams and, like, the midfield teams. Yeah, I don't know exactly if there's a relationship between Williams and Mercedes, but there's definitely a relationship between Russell and Mercedes. So I think some of them are like, the drivers, they're kind of like belong to one of the bigger teams, but if there's no spot there, they will arrange for them to drive for one of the other teams instead, you know? So there are these relationships for sure. My day's going pretty good. Did some real estate viewings today during the day. Only got to see one of the two places because the other one had, believe it or not, it was an open house and it had a freaking lineup outside the door. We waited for half an hour before we had to move on because we had an appointment. But that's because they listed that place like probably a good $150,000 below what it's going to sell for eventually. They're just trying to drive up offers. It's super annoying. The real estate market in Vancouver is nuts. But yeah, otherwise good. Played some Cyberpunk Red D&D this morning, so I don't know if you caught that, but we're not going to be having the Dragon Seers for the next couple months. So no streams there because we're waiting for Colin to complete his move back to the US. So it's been a good day. I'm looking forward to tomorrow because I don't think I have anything that I need to do. It'll be nice, relaxing, wake up in the morning, have some coffee, some croissants, some F1, go for a flight in Africa in the CJ4. I'm looking forward to it. Probably play some Red Dead in the evening, maybe, with the guys. And I also, I'm waiting for one, like, microphone stand thing that I can use to mount my GoPro in my racing cockpit. So I've got that all worked out. Started the co-op career with both BJ and Tony. So we're getting that going. That's a lot of fun. I'm driving now with a manual transmission, which is, you know, I suck at it, but I'm slowly getting better at it. So that's a lot of fun. Probably be doing a stream of that on Monday night. So... yeah, house shopping is fun, but stressful for sure, because nothing is as it seems here. Everything is bullshit to a varying degree. Whether it is sellers just jerking around with a price, or things, you know, being listed for X amount, but they've already got multiple offers for X plus 10%, 20%. Like, some of the things I've seen have sold easily 10% above asking. So I haven't crashed, though, to be honest. I haven't crashed out. I've been pretty good at that. I've been much better at that. And that's because Tony showed me a trick, and it has to do with field of view, and you actually want to be like much closer to the front of the car. It seems so much more natural. Things seem to move slower, so that's pretty good. I'm excited about that. I'll have to do that on Monday. Stream a flight tomorrow. Yeah, they do. And believe me, like, so here's the other thing is, just because I'm buying a house here does not mean that in the future I may not move out there at some point. It depends. Right now I'm pretty content here. And I don't want to make a big change, like a cross-country move. But that doesn't mean that it's not going to happen in the future, because at some point, you know, at some point I'm going to want, like, this is my first house, so it's going to be a townhouse. But at some point I'm going to want a detached home. And that's not likely to happen in this area. So when that time comes, I'll have to move. But you know what? It's going to be a lot easier to move and have some real estate already that I can, you know, sell, turn into things. So that's the future, though. Yeah, I know. Believe me, there's a part that, you know, I don't hate the idea. It's just a big change. So, and my parents are still here. I don't want to be that far away from my parents. Like, right now, I'm like an hour flight away from my parents, 5-hour drive, which is like the perfect amount of time to be away from your parents, you know? Too far away for the pop-in, but close enough to visit. I hope there's a waypoint change. Yes, there is. I hate moving as it is. I really do. There is something extremely appealing. For some reason, and I don't know what it is, but I seem to have, over my life, with the exception of very few people, I seem to have made the best friends in my life of people who live far away. Which is unfortunate. Like, my best friend lives here in town, but, you know, beyond that, it seems like most of the folks that I've spent the last decade or so hanging out with live far away. Well, it kind of gets like that when you get older, I feel, you know, it's just how it happens. All right, John, have a good evening. I'm sure we'll talk tomorrow about the Grand Prix. Have a good night. Hey, Arnold. How are things? Wasting coins? That's all good, man. See you. Have a good night.
flight attendants, please prepare for landing.
$2,500. Thank you. 1,000.
And that's it for the flight. Pretty good flight. Quite successful. Hope you enjoyed. Catch you again next time. Next flight will be, well, I don't know. We're going to be doing some more tour flights for sure. But I don't even know what the next Grand Prix is. But be good to each other. See you next time.